Well, good morning. And welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. My name is Victor, and I'm so glad that each and every one of you are here singing and worshiping
today. We'd like
to
welcome any of our first-time guests and our long-time
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him.
To find God, and through his unfailing love, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. Oh, we trust in our God, and through his unfailing love, we will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We will not be shaken. We'll be right back. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Yes, I surrender. Yes, I surrender. God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. Singing for the glory of the risen.
And tell them that you are glad they are here.
All right, before I start the story today, I have three quick jokes, and you might think these are kind of silly, and you can laugh. You ready? Why did the seahorse cross the road? To get to the other tide. See? Okay, what kind of hair do oceans have? You have a guess? No. Wavy hair. How did the fish pay for his swim lessons? Mr. Logical up here. With sand dollars. All of these are getting us ready. Next Saturday, all the kids at Asbury can come to Vacation Bible School. We're doing it different this year. because of COVID. We're having a one-day vacation Bible school from 9 to 2. They need to bring a sack lunch, and we'll have lots of fun. On Sunday, we're going to show you what we did on Saturday with a slideshow. And then after the service, the kids get to have a VBS celebration and play in the water outside. Not the rainwater, hopefully just regular old play water with water shooters and stuff. So it's all in the bulletin. Anybody has questions can ask me. And there's a Google form that the address is in the bulletin, the link is in the bulletin, and they just need to sign up before Thursday. That way we can have exactly how much stuff we need for Saturday. Thank you. All right, guys. Guess what I have in this little bag? Does anybody have any guesses?
Sand dollars.
Sand dollars would be a good guess. What? A cross? What'd you say? The cross? That's a good guess. Sunny, you have a guess? Melody, you have a guess? Do you have a guess? Oh, that would be a good guess, too. Anybody know what Bible story we might be talking about? Miss Janet says David. That's right. Yes. David, and do you know who he? Goliath. Good job. You may already know about a boy named David who fought and killed a giant named Goliath. Goliath was a mighty warrior who was more than 9 feet tall. So almost, if you put two of me on top, that would be 10 feet tall. So a little bit shorter than two of me. Can you imagine that? That's a lot bigger than you, right? Right.
Bigger than Shaq.
Yes. Can, but David was only a little boy, kind of like y'all, like Sonny and Hudson. Yes. And you? Yes, he was only a little boy. Goliath wasn't only tall, but he wore strong armor on his whole body. And he had a sword and a spear. Nope, Goliath didn't. The armor weighed 100 pounds. Did you know 100 pounds is more than each of you weigh? David, on the other hand, was a young shepherd boy. He had no armor. It was too heavy for him. He had no sword, and he had no spear. David's weapon was a slingshot and his ammunition of 5 smooth stones, which he picked up from a nearby stream. But David defeated the giant, who all the Israelite soldiers were afraid to face. We might not face a 9-foot giant. That would be very tall. But we face giants of other kinds, like being scared, insecurity, being alone, not doing well at something, failing at something. And we can remember David's 5 smooth stones to help us defeat the giants we face too. Nope, we're not going to do like Hudson and throw them at anything. But the first stone represents courage. Can you say courage? Courage. David was not afraid to face the enemy. Don't worry about a thing, David told Saul. I'll go fight the Philistine. That comes from 1 Samuel 17:32. You will use courage to face giants in each of your lives. The second stone represents confidence. Everybody say confidence. As a shepherd, David protected the sheep from wild animals. So he had confidence to face Goliath, too. The Lord who saved me from the claws of the lion and the bear will save me from the Philistine. And that comes from 1 Samuel 17:37. Like David, you can each have confidence. that God will help you overcome the problems you face. No. The third stone represents preparation. Everybody say preparation. David did not face the giant unprepared. He went to the stream. He collected 5 smooth stones in his little bag, armed it with his shepherd's staff and a slingshot. He went to fight Goliath. And that comes from 1 Samuel 17:40. It's important for you to prepare to face the challenges in your life too. The fourth stone represents trust. Everybody say trust. David did not trust in his own ability. When Goliath shouted at David, cursed him, and was ready to kill him, David said, "You come to me with a sword and a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord God Almighty." And that comes from 1 Samuel 17:45. When each of you face problems, put your trust in God, not in your own ability. And our last stone, the fifth stone, represents victory. Everybody say victory.
Victory.
It's God's battle. It's not ours, David said. That comes from 1 Samuel 17:50. That's why David had victory over the giant with only one stone and a slingshot. When you turn your battles over to God, you'll have victory over the giants in your life too. So the next time you're facing a giant in your life, remember David and Goliath and the 5 smooth stones. Let's say them again. Ready? Courage.
Confidence.
Preparation.
Trust.
Victory. Let us pray. Dear God, just as you gave David the victory in his battle with Goliath, when we put our trust in you, you will give us the victory over the giants in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So like when we made slingshots, like when we were kids, right, didn't we find like a stick that was shaped like a Y, right? And then you got like a rubber band or something and you attach to it and you, isn't that what a slingshot was? But when we see the movies and like David is fighting, doesn't he have like a long thing that he swings around? And has anybody ever, you've done that? Yeah, you've done it? Can you really aim? Wow.
It takes a lot of practice.
I bet it takes a lot of practice. Yeah.
Slingshot in David's day actually was a military weapon.
Really?
Yeah.
So they were trained.
Oh yeah, they were trained. And he was a shepherd, so he got the right.
Well, but you wouldn't use it for lambs and things, right, would you? My buddies and I were camping in Colorado one time, and we were inside the tent, and we heard this noise going on outside the tent. We unzipped the window and looked, and there was a bear that was right there in our ice chest getting food, you know, off the picnic table. And so what do you do when there's a bear in your camp, right? We jumped out of the tent and we looked around and we found rocks, right? And we just started chunking rocks at the bear. Well, he didn't leave until all the cinnamon rolls were gone, but he did leave. And then we were stupid enough the next day to go up the trail where he left to see if we could find him, right? Youth and ignorance, I guess, or bravery, whatever. Well, last week we looked at prayer and how we should, when we feel discouraged, that we shouldn't give up, that we should look up, right? And we should stay persistent in our praying. Today, we're focusing on not letting your doubts defeat you. So everybody has doubts. We all have a tendency to second guess ourselves. We'll think, did I make the right decision? You know, did I do the right thing? Now, there are different kinds of doubts. When we doubt the future, we call it worry. When we doubt other people, we call it suspicion. When we doubt ourselves, we call it inferiority. When we doubt God, we call it unbelief. When we doubt what we learn on social media, we call it intelligence. Right? When we doubt everything, we call it cynicism or skepticism. Men typically go through a period of doubt that we call a midlife crisis. We doubt our virility, our ability, and our senility. Midlife crisis is the age of the three B's: bifocals, baldness, and bulges. Well, should a Christian ever doubt? Our focus scripture today is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9. So listen to what Paul teaches us here. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. So I want to look at three causes of doubt and then talk about how to deal with our doubts. So what are some causes of doubt? Well, first, critics can cause us to doubt. We've probably all been in a classroom or at work where somebody doubted our faith. Somebody criticized our faith. Has anybody had that experience? Yeah? So I heard about a young man in school. The teacher stood up and said, "The Bible doesn't make sense. It's hard to understand. And nobody should even try to read the Bible. You can't understand it at all." And the young man raised his hand and he said, "Excuse me, teacher, but the Bible is God's love letter to Christians. And that's what you get for reading somebody else's mail." Critics can cause us to doubt. "But I don't see how you cannot believe in God. The evidence is so overwhelming to me that creation was created by a creator. To think that everything just fell into place the way it is now is like saying that I can take a watch, I can take it all apart into all of its pieces, I can put it in a bag, and I can shake the bag up, open it up, and out will pop a perfectly good working watch." Right? That's the kind of imagination that you've got to have to not believe in God. The odds of all this coming together in just the right way are astronomical. Second, our conscience can cause us to doubt. If you have a guilty conscience, then you're going to start denying your belief. It's like if I go out and I get a speeding ticket, and then I come home and I announce to Janet, "I don't believe in the speed limit." Well, that doesn't change anything. It's still a fact. I got a speeding ticket. Unbelief is often an excuse to justify our lifestyle. So a pastor was talking to a student who said, "I don't believe in God." The pastor responded, "Well, suppose God does exist. Then are there changes that you would have to make to your lifestyle?" And the student said, "Yes." Well, the pastor said, "Well, the real issue then isn't whether you believe in God or not. It's, are you willing to change?" See, our morality determines our theology. and the way that we act. If we're not careful, then we start saying things like, that's your interpretation, but I believe. Or we start saying things like, I don't care what the Bible says, what I believe is. See, our conscience can cause us to doubt God. Third, our circumstances can cause us to doubt God. And this is probably the number one reason that people doubt God. It can happen when our prayers seem to go unanswered, when a tragedy strikes, or when we're faced with some kind of an impossible situation. Jesus is out on Lake Galilee, and he's with his disciples. He's asleep in the back of the boat. In Mark 4, 35 to 41, the storm comes. And so they wake up Jesus. And what is it that they say to Jesus? Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? See, that's a typical reaction when we get under pressure. We start doubting and we think, don't you care, God? Now, Gallup has pointed out in the Gallup poll that 94% of Americans believe in God. It's not that people doubt God. It's the type of God that they doubt. Is God personal? Is God loving? Can God be depended on? Is God interested in me? Those are the kinds of doubts that people have. So critics, our conscience, and circumstances can cause us to doubt God. So how do you keep your doubts from defeating you? Now, here are three ways to deal with your doubts. First, admit your doubts. Be honest. You have some doubts. You can't overcome them unless you recognize them. For some Christians, a doubt starts to creep into their mind, and then they begin thinking things like, oh no, I may not be a good Christian. Maybe God won't love me if I have these doubts. John the Baptist was in prison. Everything was going wrong. And he sends some people to Jesus, to ask Jesus, was I wrong? Did I make a mistake? Are you not the Messiah? He has doubts. Jesus sends some people back to John to let him know who he really is. And then Jesus turns around to the crowd and he tells them, John the Baptist is the greatest man who has ever lived. Right after John has expressed his doubts about Jesus. Remember the story of Thomas. He misses out on the first resurrection appearance of Jesus. And he says, I won't believe until I see it for myself. Well, when Jesus reappears again, what does he do? Does he criticize Thomas? Does he put him down? No. Jesus opens up his arms in a loving embrace. He wants Thomas to come to love him. And Thomas becomes a greater, stronger believer than he ever was before. The point is, not even your doubts can stop God from loving you. Even if you doubt God, God still loves you. That's what the story of Thomas is all about. In Jude chapter 1, verse 22, we read, have mercy on some who are wavering. There's a difference between doubt and unbelief. Doubt is when you honestly don't know
what God wants in a particular situation. You don't even know how to pray about it because you don't know what God wants. Unbelief is when you know exactly what God wants, you've read the Bible, and you still say, I'm going to choose to do something different. Now that is unbelief, and that's sin. Have mercy on some who are wavering. Sometimes the strongest faith comes out of a struggle or struggles with your doubt. Abraham can't believe that he's going to become a dad for the first time at 90 years old. And Sarah can't believe that as an elderly woman that she's going to have her first child. So she laughs. And they named the baby Isaac. Now, we know she doesn't believe. Because if a 90-year-old woman was to get pregnant, she wouldn't laugh. She'd cry, right? So do you have doubts? Congratulations. You're human. Welcome to the club. How do you keep your doubts from defeating you? Admit your doubts, and then second, doubt your doubts. It's ironic. We usually do just the exact opposite of that. We doubt our beliefs, and we believe our doubts. That doesn't make any sense. What we need to do is believe our beliefs and doubt our doubts. Proverbs 3:5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And do not rely on your own insight." So who do you listen to the most? Do you listen to God's word, or do you listen to your own feelings? Do you think, I don't feel loved. I don't feel God in my life. I don't feel like God has a plan for me. I don't feel like I'm good enough. Do you listen to the circumstances in your life or what the Bible says? So trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. Doubt your doubts. And third, begin with whatever faith you already have. Begin with whatever faith you already have. Mark 9 is a beautiful story. A man comes to Jesus with his sick son. Jesus looks at the man and he says something like, I can heal him. If you will believe, I will heal him. And then the man makes that classic statement that we all know. In Mark 9:24, he says, I believe, help my unbelief. Can you be filled with doubt and faith at the same time? Absolutely. Can you have faith that God wants you to do something and be scared to death to do it at the same time? Sure. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is persevering in your fear. This man is filled with faith and doubt. Yet in spite of his honest doubts, he goes ahead and he goes to Jesus and a miracle happens. His son is healed. No matter how weak you think your faith is, it's enough. Matthew 17:20 says, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, nothing will be impossible for you. Everybody has faith. Now, you guys know that I was a math major, right? Janet and I met because we were math majors. Well, here's a question, an equation to remember. Little faith plus big God equals big results. You get a little faith. I believe. Help my unbelief. And you put it in a big God, and you're going to get big results. William Rainey, he started the University of Chicago and the seminary there. He once said, "Why didn't somebody ever tell me that I could be a Christian and work on my doubts at the same time?" Every little step you take towards Christ moves you further away from doubt, discouragement, depression, and despair. We all have doubts. So admit them and then doubt them. Begin with the faith that you have. Is it possible that you can have the kind of confidence that you know no matter what happens in your life between now and the time that you die, that when you die, you are going to go to heaven and be with your Father for the rest of your life? Absolutely. That's part of why the Bible was written in the first place. For example, in 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, it says, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have, that you already have eternal life." You can know without a shadow of a doubt that when you die, you're going to heaven. Now, that doesn't mean that you won't sin. But the thing is, you don't have to be perfect to go to heaven. You are to put your faith in Christ. And thank God, you don't have to work your way to heaven. If I had to work my way to heaven, I couldn't do it. To be good enough to get to God, you would have to be as good as God. And only God is perfect. I'm certainly not. Just ask Janet. She will tell you. The Bible says we all fall short. So thanks be to God that that is not the way. Jesus says, "I am the way. No one comes to the Father except through me." So put your faith in Jesus, not your own efforts. And you can know for sure. So let us pray. Loving God, thank you for your word. Thank you in spite of circumstances and our conscience and critics that we can come to you. Thank you that you understand us completely. Help us to admit our doubts so we can get them out in the open and struggle with them and overcome them. Help us to doubt our doubts and to believe our beliefs. Help us to begin with the faith that we already have. Help us to realize it just takes a little faith to do great things when we put it in a great God. And now we continue with the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." So hopefully, as we went through that, you began to think about doubts that you have, because we all have them. As you come forward this morning to accept Holy Communion, I'd like for you to, in your own mind, in your own way, even maybe while you're kneeling up here, confess your doubts to God. Ask for forgiveness for having doubts. And then release those doubts to God, knowing that with God, all things are possible, and it only takes just a little mustard seed of faith for great things to happen. If we all have just a little mustard seed, great things are going to happen in our church family. I firmly believe that, and you can believe it too. And so we remember that night when Jesus was with those that he loved more than anybody else. As they're sitting around in fellowship, isn't it great to be able to have some fellowship again? As they're sitting around in fellowship, then he takes bread and he thanks God. He blesses the bread and breaks it and gives it to them and says, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then after the meal, he takes the cup. He gives thanks to God. He blesses it and gives it to them and says, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has come. How does it go? Wow, I'm blanking out. Christ has come. Christ has died. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Prepared, so please come.
Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Breath we could ever breathe.
we live for you. And lead me in your love to those of
promise will endure, and His joy's gonna be my strength.
Thank you. It's starting to feel real now. After today, we've only got a couple of weeks together, a couple more Sundays together, and I need your help. My memory is not the greatest memory in the world, and I have stuff in my office, in the pastor's study, that I don't know if you've given it to me and you intend for me to take it with me when I go, or if you gave it to the pastor's study and you intend for it to stay, and then Chris, Pastor Chris, can enjoy it. So I've taken some stuff home, but I just don't know about all the other stuff that's in there. So if there's something that you've given me that you would like for me to take home, then if you would, please put it on the desk. If it's on the desk, I'll take it home. Otherwise, I'll leave it for Pastor Chris to be able to enjoy, okay? I've been talking to him, and he's excited to come, and I think that you're going to be very blessed to have Pastor Chris as your next pastor. Have you got some good words for us, Victor?
They're great words.
Okay.
We're going to affirm all of our beliefs, so let's join in the affirmation of faith. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Wherever we go, whatever we do, how will people know we are Christians? They will know we are Christians by our love. So here, this is your benediction. May the grace of God, the love of Christ, and the peace of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.